It's happening.
It's fucking happening.
10 years in the making.
Incredible.
I like that theme song.
It's a lot better than Bill Maher's theme song.
What is happening?
I've waited so long to come on your show.
Holy,
ladies and gentlemen.
Holy bananas.
Welcome to Bocktail.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. This is incredible. Bocktails. Right. With all that's happened.
He just blew up the microphone.
So good.
It's Rocktails live.
No, it's not. It's Bocktails.
It's Bocktails.
Bocktails.
No, fuck no.
Live at 5:15 on a Saturday.
Well, okay.
OMG.
And thank you for having me. I'm in town tomorrow. I'm doing Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp at the Whiskey with Michael Anthony from Van Halen. Tommy Aldridge from Black Oak, Arkansas.
Wow, okay.
And Warren D. Martini from Rat.
I love him.
So
love him.
This is all tomorrow at the Whiskey, but before you get excited, it's at 11 a.m. I wanted to tell 11 a.m.
But wait,
not a lot of rocking going on.
Anyone go? Sebastian
no,
Bach.
No.
No.
Well, you gotta pay.
You gotta
pay. You have to pay a lot of money.
Right. You gotta be a rich dude
who
wants to fucking feel the power of Satan in the Whiskey with. That's a crazy band.
Well, Michael Anthony, I just actually, I was a member of the Van Halen fan club when I was a little kid. I sent away for the, the packaging and they actually didn't send me it back. So I wrote Van Halen a letter. I was like 10 or 11. And I go, hey, I mailed you guys $5 and I didn't get anything. Like, what's up? Signed, Sebastian. They sent me a letter back saying, dear Sebastian, we'll have you know that mail fraud is a serious offense, sir. And you better. And I was like a little kid. This was from Van Halen to me. Mail fraud is a serious offense, Sebastian. And it was like a legal letter saying.
I went backstage at same age, right? Okay. Like 10 or thereabouts. Mm-hmm. And my experience was different. It was David Lee Roth. Like, hey, little man. Handed me a bottle of Jack Daniels in a brown paper bag. He's like, you want some?
Crazy.
Yeah.
Well, I mean.
How many other, in the Rush documentary, you said you were basically the president of the Rush fan club in your local area.
Well, I'll clarify that, but yes.
Okay, clarify that.
Do you want to hear the clarify? Okay. Any Rush fan, if you're wearing the Signal shirt, you're a Rush fan. So you know who Andrew McNaughton was, right? Which was Rush's personal photographer for years. And he unfortunately passed away before Neil Peart did. But I went to a school called Lakefield College School, which is where Prince Andrew went on exchange from Gordonston. This is all real. No, I don't know. Fucking Epstein guy. I wasn't there for that.
Right. Yeah.
Don't put me in with that.
It's weird because I
this was before that period.
You texted me earlier before you're in the show. It's like, hey, don't mention my good pal.
Sex Island. Yeah.
You're like, I don't want to talk about that on the show. And I was like, okay, but all right. We'll pretend like you guys weren't like this. All right. You know.
Anyway, so I went to that school, and my roommate in the dorm, it was an all-boys school.
Right.
The only set of tits was on the English teacher, Mrs. Brown, and her class was packed every fucking, you couldn't get a seat for that. It was like, multiplication is my favorite class.
Yeah.
Anyway, so my roommate was a guy named George Jeffries, and we all loved Rush, and one day he comes in, he goes, hey, my cousin is starting a Rush fan club called the Backstage Club of Rush. And his cousin was Andrew McNaughton.
Wow.
So the Rush Backstage Club of Toronto, I think it was called. So my cousin, my friend, George, he was my best friend. He was member number one. And he goes, you want to join? I go, what? Are you crazy? Take my money. Yeah. And so I go, and because you're number two, and then the fans were numbered on the card, and I had a number two. I was a number two. And Getty in his book says, he describes this kid, Andrew, went to his house with this club, and that was the club. And it's weird.
That's
right?
Awesome.
So you got you right, Van Halen. You're in the Rush Van. You're in the Kiss Army.
Oh yeah. Here's my story for that. So me and my cousin Kevin.
Welcome to Bocktails.
Me and my cousin Kevin. We apply for membership in the Kiss Army at the same time. We want to enlist.
Did you use the form in the Love Gun album that came and you fill it out and send it in?
One of those albums. Yeah. So how about this? So this was all my idea, and Kevin's totally into it. We do it the same day. We send it in. I get a phone call from my cousin, my aunt. He gets his Kiss Army package before I get mine.
Oh, no.
And I go, you cannot be serious. I go, you can't be serious. He's like, yeah, dude, I got it right here. I go, Mom, get in the car. She goes, what? We're going to Kevin's house. And I march the fuck in his fucking room. I go, listen, I'm going to sit in this chair. You are going to sit over there. My back is going to be to you. You are going to open the Kiss Army package and describe every fucking thing in there. But you're not going to show me anything, you bastard.
Wow.
He's like, all right.
And all that. He's like, okay, well. Here's a sticker of Peter Chris.
I go, get out of here! You don't fucking have that!
Well, here's an Ace standee.
What? What do you mean? You fucking fucking god! Like, it was torture. And I was like crying, I think. Like, I couldn't believe that they Kiss sent it to him first.
The sons of bitches.
Did they not know?
It's not fair. But you got yours eventually, right?
I did, yeah.
Same day? I mean, next day?
No, it was like a week later. But
oh, my God. It's torture.
That was a tragedy at the time.
Oh, my God.
But those are good memories, though.
Well, Sebastian, I have to say, I mean, this truly is a delightful to have you here. Mm-hmm. I don't think I've seen. Look at Brendan's laughing so hard.
So bad. I'm already sweating.
Like,
oh my God, you're soaked.
Yeah. Are you? Did you get?
I'm so happy.
And
you missed his fist bump. Like, we don't disrespect Baz like that.
You're falling apart, bro.
I'm falling apart. My fucking idol's here.
Stop.
Okay. I did you get super high in preparation for the
I
show?
I got super high. I took two gummies right before I came in.
Really?
Yeah.
Of what? Crystal meth?
Yeah.
Like, I took two crystal meth gummies. They fucking hit hard. Oh, my God.
Yeah, that's kind of like what it seems like.
Yeah, falling apart. I'm so happy. Hey,
I have to thank you all, man, for the pandemic. Like, I mean, not to be
thank you for the pandemic.
You're welcome.
Thanking you for being there during the pandemic. Here was my pandemic routine.
Okay.
I would wake up as late as I could because there's nothing to do except cameos. Thank God.
Yeah.
That was crazy. Money dropping out of the fucking sky. But anyways, my routine would be, okay, what do I do today? Okay. I've watched all of Netflix. I've watched the whole Blu-ray series, $6 Million Man. I've gone through my box set of WKRP. I've watched everything, for fuck's sakes. Yeah. There's nothing else.
Wait, the box set of WKRP in Cincinnati?
My favorite show. I love it. I love that show.
Baby, if you ever wondered whatever became of me.
I'm living on the air in Cincinnati.
Cincinnati WKRP.
I'm on WKRP.
No, excuse me. I got tired of packing and unpacking. Town to town, up and down the dial. Well, maybe you and me were never meant to be. Just maybe think of me once in a while. I'm a WKRP in Cincinnati.
Yeah! Okay.
Wow.
So
So, second verse.
Yes.
So this show also very meaningful to me as well. Yeah. I don't know why there hasn't been another format show. I mean, I think Frasier sort of tried to do that a little bit, but I love the inner workings of the radio kind of situation, behind the scenes.
There's
right?
two moments in that show that changed my personality.
Oh, really?
Yeah. When they changed the format in the first episode, when it's like a classical station, they go to rock.
Yep.
When Dr. Johnny Fever, they go, okay, do it. And he's like, okay. And then he
goes, do it.
And he takes the needle and he goes, and he goes, listen, babies, we're coming at you, motherfucker. We're going to fucking get you. He does all that. And then he puts on rock and he starts playing air guitar and jump. That scene to me is pure rock joy and fun. And when I was a kid, I was like it just hit me. And also, when Andy Travis gets the gig and he gets his desk and they go, what are you going to do to the station? He goes, I don't know. And he puts up the Kiss Bicentennial poster on the wall. Like, forget it. And you remember that scene?
Yeah.
And he puts it up and the crowd, like, it wasn't a laugh track. It was like, oh, like, that's bad.
I think you might be my best friend at this point. I mean, like, I don't
understand. He's like a kid
growing Jack Black
out.
Had a baby.
I feel like I've missed out on so much of my life by not being your friend.
Well,
I'm now actually kind of miserable. You're mentioning, I feel so connected to the things that you're talking about.
I changed my life.
But I was on the drive over here. I was nervous picking you up. All right, for a few reasons. One, I need to test your highest notes. Because you might be maybe the person with the most powerful voice in rock and roll, okay? And I need to know, right, in a 1989 vocal combat challenge, right? Uh-huh. Who do you think could destroy the audience, their ears more? Tom Kiefer, right? Who has a big voice.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
You, right? Or Ronnie James Dio. These are the things as a kid, right? Or
choosing out of those three and who can destroy the audience the
like
most with the notes?
The big voices. They're like literally being able to hit the notes, stay in the note and fucking crush them.
By those criteria.
Well, those are the people.
By those criteria.
Yeah.
Of those three.
Yeah.
I would pick Rob Halford.
Oh, wow.
Oh, okay.
Rob Halford, if you're talking about who can hit the highest note and destroy the crowd, that's the guy that can do
Sinner!
That. No, forget it.
I think
forget
he's Sinner!
I saw him recently in Vegas, and I have it on my phone. It's like the whole show, he's working up to something, right? He's like building up, and then he just kind of goes, and his eyes roll back, and his lightning juice goes, with this fucking note that is like nothing you ever heard. And he holds the mic like a foot away from his mouth.
But so do you, dude.
No, I mean, we have different voices. I can go very high, but he has a freak, like falsetto kind of thing. I don't sing falsetto. Neither the deal, really.
No, I mean, that's.
But he did like, you know, at the beginning of like Children of the Sea and stuff.
My God,
I love that.
I love it.
Yeah, that's heavy. And Sign of the Southern Cross.
It's a sign of the Southern Cross. So good.
Love it.
I can't hit any of those fucking notes. I got to go full falsetto. You're like, you guys are all just in your chest doing that shit, no?
Well, there's a whole warm-up routine that I'd go through for weeks.
Can I describe it? Because you told me this in the car. This is what you do. You just have a lot of yogurt, like like a ton of whole milk yogurt as a prep, right? And then you're like two Twinkies on either side, and you kind of do like Bluto from
Greece.
Yeah, and do that, the pimple thing. What else do you do to prep?
Stand on my head. Do bicycles while I'm standing on my head.
That's good.
No, I don't do that.
You have to also be the funniest person in music as well. I mean,
I can be.
If people haven't heard your audiobook, which is a must.
Have you heard it?
Dude, it's the greatest thing of all time because you go, bonus. And then you'll smoke or have a drink or something. And you go, you just go completely off topic in the book. And it's amazing. Wow. And no one's ever fucking done that.
You know, I can say something about that. First of all, when you agree to read your 400-page book into a mic, it's a lot more hours than you're anticipating.
Yeah.
So I'd be in this booth from, 9 a.m. till 6, just talking till my pipes were fucking zapped. God, can I get a breath here? And I had a lot of fun writing that book. So
But you're so honest. And the thing is, when you were going through, at least what it sounds like to me, when you're going through on your audiobook, you're filling in all of these things that were maybe stuff you're like, I don't know if you edited them out or you're like, oh, I remembered something that I should tell you now. It's an incredible, first of all, your story is incredible. You're so personal in what you're talking about. But the fucking funniest shit of all time is how you go fucking off the rails.
Well, the lady that was directing me doing that, like day three or something, she goes, Sebastian. I go, yeah. She goes, I think you might be laughing a little too much. And I go, I'm not trying to laugh. I'm not saying it. Oh, I'm going to laugh at this point. Like, I'm fucking laughing. Like, it's ridiculous. And she goes, just keep doing it. Just keep doing it.
It's incredible. Incredible.
Have you ever thought about doing, a storytelling tour?
I did, actually. When my book came out, I did a two-week tour that was more storytelling and stuff, yeah.
Was that satisfying or no?
It was great, man. I love books. Like, I read books. I collect fucking books. Well, I know that's weird, but I do. Well, and when somebody says, they wanted me to write a book just like everybody else, and at first they wanted me to have a co-writer, which doesn't interest me, because I don't want to read somebody else's take. And so I said, I want to write the book. And they go, okay, smarty pants. Mm-hmm. They go, you have to show us you can write a fucking book.
Right.
Genius. So I go, okay, let me try. And I locked myself in my room for 2 weeks. And they go, write one chapter. And I fucking tortured myself until I was really happy with what I wrote. And I gave it to HarperCollins. They go, congratulations. you can write your book. And I go, oh, that's good. Because I'm just a control freak, too. I enjoy making things.
But you seem to be you seem to be a sponge, right, for the things that you love. So, I don't know you very well. We've hung out a few times, said hi. And I'll tell you the first time we actually met backstage, because I can't remember what year, and I want to know if you remember this moment. I think I've talked about it on the show before, but we were at a Bowl for Ronnie Stand Up for Cancer event.
Oh, right? Okay.
This is not when we first met, but we were there at the same thing, and then you had people over after to your house when you lived in Studio City.
That was crazy.
And so this night that we went over, it's cool to see the stuff that you like. You had pictures that your dad had painted on the walls, which were incredible. Mm. But a lot of the stuff that you collected, and you were, in my opinion, on one where you're like, no, guys, we're doing this. Like, what should I play next? You're going through your vinyl collection.
Yeah.
And you were so intensely serious in a really fun way. About are we doing this? Are we going to fucking celebrate Kiss right now? And you just brought all this fucking passion, and you're playing host to everyone, And I did, and this is the impression that I got. I don't think that your wife. I think she was not happy.
What?
She was not happy.
She was not happy.
Were you there too?
Yeah.
We
didn't expect that many people to come over.
Okay, that's what I was
like,
gonna say.
The whole fucking bowl for Ronnie in Sebastian's living room.
Basically.
But you were kind of like, let's go, go.
Well, that's my nature.
I know. And your wife is like, who the fuck are all these people?
I said hi. I thank you for having us in your home. And she's like, honestly, she's like, you should just leave. Everyone should leave.
No
she didn't
way.
Say that. She didn't say that.
Well, we brought in bags of tequila and put them out on the counter. And she walked out and she was like, what is happening?
Yeah.
And I had a great time that night.
And this was something that I hadn't seen before because I've never smoked pot. I've never taken any drugs. I don't know if you know that. But I've been around tons of people who do that. But this was the first time that you were growing your own marijuana
outside.
Outside.
Yes.
And I got the sense.
Six plants.
I got the sense that you like named these plants that they were like.
I probably did.
Yeah, they were like your kids or something like that.
That's a legal thing you can do. I have a fucking license in my wallet from the state of Nevada. Now.
No one's coming after you.
No, but I'm just saying
don't have to worry about
it. All legal.
This was in California. Yes. This is not like we're not talking
about Studio City weed.
I know, but I didn't have enough sun in my backyard.
Yeah, that's like, what, you had them on carts.
Because every 20 minutes, I go, I got like 2 feet of fucking sun. Yeah. I'm like, it's going to be killer weed, man. Like, I'm going to push it over here.
You're like singing to it.
I even asked my neighbors, I said, could you cut some fucking trees down so I don't have to push this cart around?
And you said, do you know why they're on carts? And I was like, to follow the sun? And he goes,
I don't realize that's funny, but I'm like tearing up right now. That is ridiculous.
So the first time.
Well, you were just so proud of these.
Have a relationship with the plant.
You did.
And
that's
I actually like just growing it. Like,
yeah.
I just like seeing it grow. Yeah. And
well, it seems.
I do.
They were fucking impressive.
Yeah. It seems.
I was on the cover of High Times in '93.
Oh.
When it was not legal at all. Not at all.
Well,
it was me, Cypress Hill, the Black Crows, forging the fucking path for the rest of you.
You're welcome.
You're welcome.
You're welcome.
Fucking
welcome.
Trailblazer, literally.
Yeah. So the things that you are passionate about, you're all in. That's my point. I mean, there was a lot of cool memorabilia, but curated and quality stuff. Like, I think aesthetically too. You got such a fucking vibe. You're not like you're a super passionate fan, and not the average super fan. Like, if that makes sense. Like, I think you have a real perspective and a love of music, and I think that your new music is, your first single is such a fucking banger. It's so good to have you. You know, rocking our eardrums back. I'm so excited for the rest of the record. We've only heard two tracks, I want to hear all about that. I have way too many questions. And then I think at some point we should try to also talk about maybe a little Thin Lizzy if we get to it. Because I know how much you love Thin Lizzy and we want to celebrate, the Irish.
Right.
So.
On St. Patrick's Day.
Yes.
That was the idea, but...
Yeah, well, we'll
see. And I also want to thank you guys for being there for all of us during the time when we couldn't leave the house. I was trying to explain what my routine typically was in the pandemic. And I'd wake up and I'd go, okay, there's nothing to do, really. I would shoot cameos, which was incredible to me, that I had a job in my fucking house without leaving the house. I was like, okay, that's neat.
Oh, bro, I think I saw one that was...
That was pretty ridiculous.
Yeah, that was something that I was like...
Crazy.
Wow.
Yeah, I was very bored, like extremely bored. So I was like, you want a video? I'm going to make you a fucking 40-minute video.
Jesus.
Like, I was just bored out of my mind. And you guys, Rocktails, I would get in my... I would look at my watch. I go, I can't start drinking it this time. I got to give it a couple more hours. Like, wanted to, you know, I mean, this is getting crazy, but there's nothing to do.
Yeah.
So at some point I would give in and I'd get in my hot tub.
Oh, that's so get, you just cook
get
yourself
some
alive.
Red wine, fucking crank up Rocktails. And your laugh, Brendan, soothed me in these rotten times. I like the sound of your laugh. Every time you laughed, I would laugh with you, you know, in my hot tub.
People have drinking games to his laugh. Every time he laughs, they have to do shots.
Dude, fucking great. I mean, as the great Neil Peart once said, praise from the praiseworthy is the highest form of praise.
What? That is a Neil Peart quote, for real.
So, I mean, that's like, I'm done. I can go. I'm going to go. Bye. Very nice meeting you. Good to see you. But I laugh because I've known these guys for so fucking long. So I know the real stories.
Okay.
So all he has to do is just say like a couple words and I'm gone.
Right on.
No, but you're killing him right now. This is real special.
As we're talking about Neil Peart's quotes, I just read Geddy Lee's fantastic book, My Effin' Life. And I've been watching him promote it on YouTube, watching his interviews. He goes around the world and he did one and he's talking about Neil Peart. And he's like, Neil Peart refused to play the same drum fill twice in the song. Like, and then he tells his story. He goes, they'd be in rehearsal and Neil would do a killer fill and Geddy and Alex would say, that's great. He goes, can you do that again? And he goes, What? And Geddy would say, I love that fill. Can you play? It's a great fill. He goes, yes, but does that mean we have to play it twice? Geddy would go, oh, fuck. I gotta get there. Well, does it? You can find out. I laughed my fucking head off when I saw
who's it. Your best? I relate who's to your that. Best? Rock impersonation. I bet you could do Gene.
I can do Gene.
I bet
good.
You could do Ronnie. Like
Ronnie James Dio?
Who's your best? Like talking voice impersonation.
Okay, well, are you guys buddies with Craig Gass? Do you know him? Comedian?
I know he's a comedian.
He does a lot of these rock impersonations. And one time in probably the early 2000s or maybe late 90s, I was at home in New Jersey and I hear over the answer machine, Sebastian, this is Gene Simmons of Kiss. And I go, holy fucking Gene Simmons is calling me right now. So I go over to the answer machine.
Your phone mate?
Yeah. Well, it was a fax machine.
Wow.
It was.
Fancy.
So here's my message I hear. And I'm freaked out because I love Kiss. And he goes, this is Gene Simmons of Kiss. Sebastian, we have a business venture opportunity for you. We want to know if you'd like to be part of this business with this. Sebastian, I'm talking about Kiss Chili. and I go, what? I'm all free. He goes, I'm talking about a combination of tomato sauce with garbanzo beans and meat. Ground beef. It's blended into a pleasing goulash. This is Kiss Chili. We want to know if you'd like to get in on the ground level with us, Sebastian. Thank you. Bye. Click. And I go, fucking, I'm going to be part of Kiss Chili. I have been asked by Kiss.
Oh, my God.
To be a fucking, I am going to be part.
Oh, my God.
Of Kiss Chili. It's a combination of tomato sauce, fucking garbanzo beans, fucking ground beef, and a pleasing goulash. And then I go, this can't be real. And I listen, but I didn't say this can't be real. I thought it was real.
Yeah.
I thought it was. Why wouldn't they have Kiss Chili? They have everything else.
They should.
They should now.
I have a Kiss Waffle Machine. So if you're the owner of a Kiss Waffle Machine, Kiss Chili's not that far
fetched.
No. Yeah. Right? Oh, my God.
So that was Craig Gass playing a good one. I can do a good Vince Neil.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, let's hear that one.
Well, fuck you! Yeah! Yeah, well, fuck
Shout at the devil! Fuck you! Fuck yeah! Well, fuck you, man!
Oh my god! Do you know? Do you know?
Yeah, well, fuck you!
Do you know? If we go back to our texts,
say it as high as you can, like you just did a rail blow.
Yeah, well, fuck you! Shout at the devil! Shout!
Because
he's a world screamer on me in the night. He's a blood stain on the stain. Fuck you! Well, fuck you and fuck Doc!
But you're,
fuck your man! Your manager's a fucking asshole!
Ow.
He's
breaking
up. Help. He's going like this. He's going like this really microphone. Good. Earplug.
Help. Help.
Those
help.
Crystal meth gummies are kicking in.
Yeah. Oh my god.
Oh my god.
Oh my god. I've been out with Vince. Like, you think you guys can drink? He can fucking drink.
Really?
Oh my god.
Yeah.
One time I was doing a show, VH1, Forever Wild, we were in Florida, and Vince, Neil, and Tommy Lee were my guests, and
oh god.
I'm in my hotel room, and the phone rings in my hotel room, and I pick it up, and all I hear is a dog barking. Go, and I go, Vince? And he goes, he's talking to me in dog. And I go, what are you doing?
Oh my god.
He's going, row, 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 row. And I go, what? And he goes, you got any pot? And I go, yeah. I go, who are you talking to here? And he goes, well, I don't want it. But Judd Nelson wants them. And I hang out with Judd Nelson, so and I go, okay, here you go. So then he goes, come down to the pool, man. I go, it's fucking 9 a.m. Come down to the pool. He goes, I got a case of Heineken down here. I go, it's 9 a.m. What are you going to be doing at 5 p.m.? If you're drinking a case of Heineken. So I go down to the pool. There's nobody at the pool except Vince by himself and a case of fucking Heineken. And I go, fuck.
Where's,
he goes, sit down, man.
Judd
so
Nelson?
He just start 9 in the morning. I don't know if he wasn't there.
Where was Judd Nelson? Yeah.
No, it was me and Vince in a case of Heineken at 9 a.m. And that was the day that the next day I flew home and went to jail for terroristic threats. Because I can't start drinking at 9 in the morning. No, I try. I fuck.
Well, yeah.
Then I end up in jail.
Well, so,
like, you can Google that. It's so, like time. So,
I asked
9 a.m. at the pool, killing a case of Heineken. Next day, jail.
Yeah. Well, so I said to you, hey, we got some nice wine. We know you like wine. Yeah. And I was like, I'll pour you a glass.
I don't like it. I love it.
And you're like, yeah, no.
No.
Ask me to tell you the story why I don't drink on a live broadcast.
Do you happen to remember a television program by the name of Supergroup?
I do. Yes.
Me, Ted Nugent.
Yes.
Okay.
Evan Seinfeld, Scott Ian.
Yes.
I'll never forget the review in TV Guide. It was so succinct. It said Supergroup. Well, it's a group. And that was the whole review. I was like, fucking good. Whoever wrote that, brevity is the soul of wit. And this motherfucker nailed it.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's why you don't.
Supergroup. Well, it's a group.
And that is not why. That's why you don't drink.
I will go into detail. Okay, this is a reality show, and we lived in the house together for 2 weeks, and I didn't really know the tricks of the industry at that point. And one of them is don't feed the cast, just let them drink. Then you're going to get some good shit on film.
Yeah.
Right. So one night, we're done filming, doing what we're going to do. Of course, you're never done filming. And so we go, let's order some pizza. Perfect for dinner. Okay, right on. It's fucking 6:30. Pizza's coming. This is going to be great. Let's have some wine while we're waiting for the pizza.
No.
So I start drinking wine.
Okay.
So 45
minutes. There we go.
Hey, is the pizza here yet? Nope, not yet. Should be here soon. All right, fuck it. 9:30. Where's the fucking pizza, man? Is the pizza coming? Is it coming? Is it here? Should be here soon, Sebastian. Wow. Have another. Okay, well, it's coming, right?
Dirty trick. Right.
Oh, fucking 11 p.m. Where's the fucking pizza? I gotta soak some of this up. So, and this is all being filmed.
Oh.
Now, not to get heavy, but my dad died like a month before filming, or very close to this. So I was not in a good mood.
Yeah.
And I'd be drunk and a camera guy would say, it's time for the one-on-one interview. And I'd be like, okay. And he'd go like, so how does it feel really, like, you know, your dad like dying and stuff?
Oh.
And I'd go, how the fuck would it feel to you is my question to you. How the fuck do you think it fucking feel? So I'm going, oh, this show went great.
Oh my God.
So I would cry, right? And then I remember flying home saying, well, that went pretty good. I had a pretty good time filming that. I only cried like once about my dad. Like, that's not so bad. Then, as the show is being promoted on VH1, the commercial is of me crying. That's the commercial for the show.
No.
Supergroup, 9 p.m., tune in. I'm like, I'm going, what the fuck? I'm never doing that again. Except for today. No. No, I don't drink on TV. Wow. But this is the internet, right?
Yeah, it's not really TV.
It's not really TV.
And we're only on for an hour. So it's,
yeah.
It's okay.
Well, maybe near the end I'll partake with
you. Well, I want to just get this out in the open. I was texting with you, and I forget what show it was. I could probably go back to our texts. And you fucking hammered me.
About
so,
what?
So hard.
What?
About, and it was a real life lesson for me, because I was being pretty snarky about the band. Like, oh, dude, they sounds like, I think it was like, so-and-so sounds like shit or something. And your whole point of view was...
I vaguely remember this.
And I was like, dude, he's never coming on Rock Tales. This on, never happened.
What were we talking about?
I can go back and look at it. But it was, but what you said, and this is why I think there might be some misunderstandings. I mean, people have strong feelings about, intense feelings about the band breaking up and all the beef and all of those things. And I have to say, you know, I hang out with you. And in a moment like this, you're totally open, authentic, speak your mind, have your own real opinions. Mm-hmm. And you fucking are so serious about when someone is going out on stage, right? Mm-hmm. And giving that performance to the audience. You were like telling me, like, dude, you have to have respect for what's happening.
I remember who you were talking about.
Yeah, I don't really want to talk about the band, but like I was saying, like, can you, and I was not being, I thought you were like, yeah, this is not great, because in my opinion, it wasn't great. And in your opinion, you were like,
you
fuck
were,
you, bro.
No, I wasn't saying fuck you, bro, but you were talking about a guy that was old, and I took what you were saying, like, you were saying he's too old, and he's, and I don't like someone.
Well, hold on. I don't know if I said old.
No, but that you were saying, like, you know, he wasn't what he used to be or something like that.
Ahmed, if you could cry right now, I'd really appreciate it.
I will. You know what? I'll.
But that's how I took it.
The greater point was in my lesson, which I learned in that scenario, and I guess we can, you know, I could take the time to find it if we wanted to. But what I want to say is, with gratitude, I was like, wow. I mean, I really thought from what I thought I knew about you, right? Because I was just trying to be funny and I wasn't enjoying the performance. I still don't think it was a great performance.
Right.
But your whole thing was, no, this person is a fucking living legend. Yeah. And, you know, this person playing this right now, kind of like, fuck you, this is still kind of incredible. You just had this whole way of reframing. And I was like, wow, shame on me. No. Genuinely shame on me. And I think I expressed that or tried to, in the text back to you. And that was fucking awesome. So I just want you to know, I think I I know I will forever be in your debt and in your corner because of that sort of simplicity. And, you know, I can certainly have my moments where I think I'm, you know, my shit doesn't stink or whatever. And that was a fantastic reminder of how hard it is to be out there on the road day to day playing. It was like a really great reminder of, so, okay, a band is playing in my town. I'm going to go and I expect X, Y, or Z. And then I should know better because I know how hard it is to, A, there's a whole crew to put up the show and you're expected to go
even
and do.
Even to get there is fucking hard. Like, just and, to get the gig.
So, so I'm looking forward to your shows because I know with integrity and what you want to give to an audience, right? And still have a good time, have because it's fun to play these shows.
It is.
All of that, right? So I have truly mad respect for you, and I'm excited for you, especially off the heels of your fucking two tracks off this record are punch you in the face, punch you in the throat, blow your eardrums up.
No, I want to say, like, I think we should, like, get into the new record.
Yes.
I think we should listen to
I would
to
like
those
to address
tracks.
This point, but yes, I would too. New album's called Child Within the Man. It's coming out May 10th, but you can pre-order it right now on the Linktree and all my socials.
We'll,
but let me
we'll
address
put it out there.
Let
we'll
me address what you were saying.
Please.
We live in a world now where technology is taking over, and so many bands rely on backing tracks. It's well known. That's the way it is now.
Yeah.
My position on that, like I always hear people, Paul Stanley of Kiss is using a backing track. And my thing is, Paul Stanley has given us all fucking 50 years of entertainment.
My entire
life. All he's trying to do is keep doing it one more time. The dude is in his 70s. He has to put on foot-high platform boots, makeup, make his body fucking skinny and rock. Mm-hmm. He has to strap himself onto wires and fly across the arena. Like, my mom is 82. I love my mom. I can't see her strapping on boots and spitting blood breathing fire.
That's right.
My point is, if Paul Stanley or somebody in their 70s,
to be clear, we were not texting about Paul Stanley.
No.
You're using that example.
But I do know who we were talking about.
But we were not, for clarity's sake.
If somebody that is older is trying to put on a entertainment show and they need some technology to help them get through it, and they're that old, I don't mind that. What I do mind is having a band that's 23 open for me that doesn't even try to fucking do the singing or the backgrounds or they don't it's not even like they're just gonna run that shit. That's ridiculous to me. But if you've got like Phil Collins in a fucking wheelchair,
do you know who
give him a break. And my point is, say like have some respect for all that these guys have done. Like don't follow around.
That was a really great reminder.
That's the way I look at it.
And I do think that there's more people certainly that share your point of view. There's one band in particular who recently, who I love. There's this band, Larkin Poe.
Oh, yeah.
And then Steven Tyler and Tyler Bryant and the Shakedown.
Yes.
Not Steven Tyler. Tyler Bryant and the Shakedown. Love Tyler, Rebecca. But, you know, they're connected via marriage, and all of those guys hang out and make great music. Mm-hmm. But I was fortunate enough to be a fly on the wall where they were talking about it's so important for them to be able to pull off their music live. This is an authentic, like that's the experience. You're going to hear live music.
Right.
And even on social media now too, where, you know, to be a new band, and I'm sure you are dealing with these same issues of trying to connect with your existing fan base and make new fans. And, you know, what is this way to you're starting it now, promoting your new record, the stuff that you're gonna figure out your own path forward to kind of maintain those
and
connections.
A big tour. Yeah, a lot of dates,
big tour,
right? Which we should talk about.
And
that's only the first leg. There's already a whole nother fucking tour that's booked that I haven't announced yet. It's crazy.
This just in, Sebastian Bach is about to announce the new tour dates that no one knows about. Baz, you were saying?
I didn't say anything like that. No. I'm playing the Wacken Festival in Germany for like 100,000 people.
Whoa.
That's fucking awesome!
But I don't know if I'm allowed to say that yet, but... Well, I am.
You just did.
So,
yeah. You just did.
So then all you Germany rock and roll fans, European fans, I will see you at Wacken.
You're going down to South America.
Yeah. Uruguay, Chile, Kiss Chile.
Yeah. With Garzambo beans.
Garzambo beans.
Yeah, I love Garzambo beans.
Take a call.
Yeah. This is call roulette, okay?
So, all right, yeah. Can we play some of the new music?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
But hello, caller. You are on Bach Tales with Sebastian Bach. Who are you? Where are you calling from? And what are you drinking?
Can you guys hear me?
We can hear you.
Perfect. Well, this is your friend Zeus from Shout It Out Loudcast here in Boston.
Oh, cool.
We just had Ahmed on the show. We were talking all Kiss. So now that you're on this show, I'm curious. We didn't even ask you this, Ahmed, but I'm going to ask you and Sebastian. Anybody else want to add? I'm sure we all saw The End of the Road.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there a deep cut that you wish was on that set list?
I was at the very, very last show. And
so were we.
And I was drinking wine during the show, and then Gene got mad at me after the show for drinking wine. In full makeup.
Oh, that,
he was like, yeah. Sebastian. I was like, dude, my doctor tells me to drink red wine. I'm sorry, like, to disappoint you. Like, he says, do that for your heart. Sorry, Gene.
Right.
Like, and also, it's not too much fun. Watching your favorite fucking band end.
And you
like,
did you cry? I cry.
Yes, I cry all the time. That's how I know I like something. Yeah. If I cry at fucking Barney Fife in Andy Griffith's show. And I'm like, what is wrong with me? Like, why is
you like, have a Pisces,
something
you have a Pisces
that
man.
He'll do, something, the end of Little House on the Prairie, I'll fucking Michael Landon will do something. I'll be like, he's the best fucking dad in the world. And I'm like, what is wrong with me?
Jesus.
Like, no, so, I like so, show, shows.
So what was the track that you think they should have played that they didn't play?
Well, I mean, gosh.
Was it Great Expectations?
Well, I mean, I have a three favorite ones that I don't think they played. I love Take Me off Rock and Roll Over because of the lyrics. Me and my friends on the playground, we were like, do you know what he says in this song? And they'd be like, what? And I'd go, put your hand in my pocket, grab onto my rocket. Feels so good to see you, Lucille. Baby got to know, do you want to blow? How you gonna make me feel? And we'd go, he doesn't fucking say that. I go, yeah, he does.
So
sitting in the back, your head down in my lap, the moonlight shining down overhead. The radios are playing, my fingers just a straying. Her mama didn't know she was there. No, she said, whoa, baby, you make me feel, yeah. Wow, 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 wow. Whoa, baby, you make me feel, yeah. So take me. That fucking tune.
Wow.
Rips.
How's that for an answer, Zeus?
Come on.
Call.
That's awesome.
Also calling Dr. Love. Well, yeah. But they might have played that. I also love Christine 16.
Christine!
Because
16.
That was actually a hit song when I was a kid.
They tried
on
to fucking
AM
cancel
radio.
Them.
Yeah.
For their
I remember choice. Being in the back of my dad's car. It was dark at night. He went in the grocery store or something, and they played Chris. I couldn't. I was like, holy
so
shit.
Do you know that?
I love that
do
song.
Do you know the Cynthia Plastercaster?
Yes, I know all about it.
But do you know that? I was friendly with Cynthia Plastercaster. Like that was a trip for me. So
wow.
For me, Kiss I am turning 50 this year.
Congratulations.
So Kiss for me has been my band my entire life.
I have to ask you this.
Okay.
Did your dad ever say or mention anything about Kiss?
Did he ever say anything, or mention anything about anything. Kiss?
Like, what was your dad's opinion? I'm very curious on that. Or did he even have one?
Well, he knew Gene.
Yeah.
But I mean the band. Like, because I know your dad loved the song Supernaut by Black Sabbath.
Oh, yeah.
So he must have loved some.
I don't. Metal. I wish I could tell you specifically. I'd maybe have to find out from Dweezil or from Moon.
Did he ever give you Kiss records or buy you any shirts?
I had all that stuff. I mean, like
from
this
Dad.
My dad didn't really give me anything.
No.
I mean, you know,
cigarettes.
I would get him cigarettes. I think as an example, I played, like, the only game I ever played with my dad was pickup sticks, and I think I did that once.
What is that game even?
You know, like,
you bounce a ball and pick them up, right?
No, pickup sticks is like they look like giant toothpicks, and you drop them all
right,
together,
okay.
And you can't let any of the other sticks that are touching each other shake at all. So it's kind of like Jenga, but
okay.
Not really.
All right.
And it's. Exactly. You don't even know the fucking game, and that's the only thing I played with him.
Okay.
Let's try one more call.
Okay. All right. We were just getting deep on some family shit.
The pickup sticks. Yeah. I get it.
Sorry.
Hello?
Okay. All right.
Hello?
It's you're on Bob
Tales. I have a new album. It's called Child Within the Man. Get on my fucking website.
Yeah, well, we're gonna talk all about that with the new caller to Bach Tales, live with Sebastian Bach.
What's
who
up
are
there,
you?
There?
Where are you calling from, and what are you drinking?
Joe from Raymond, New Hampshire.
Joe, New Hampshire.
Joe in New Hampshire is a loyal.
Very cool.
Hey, I'm ready to go for my top five Canadian bands with Sebastian Bach.
Okay. Quick. Sounds good.
Jesus. Joe, come on. You've been drinking, Joe. Come on.
I can tell he's been drinking.
Yeah, let's get on with the, list, Joe.
Okay.
I've got my Teeling's Irish whiskey.
What language is that?
See, this is the best part.
This is Joe.
We have great callers.
This is why I don't drink on your show.
but they have cocktails with us.
All right. So obviously, I've seen Rush 31 times in my favorite band.
Wow.
Triumph's my number two.
Nice.
I love Our Lady Peace, mm-hmm. I Mother Earth. And I love Honeymoon Suite for my 80s.
Okay.
So I need Sebastian to suggest me a sixth band that I haven't heard from Canada.
You didn't mention April Wine.
Easy. Well, that too.
Thank you, Joe.
But I would say if you've seen Rush 31 times, you have seen Max Webster.
Oh, that's a deep
cut. Because they opened up for Rush many times in America. And incredible band and very, very kind of like Rush in a lot of ways. In fact, on their album Universal Juveniles, they did a song called Battle Scar with Rush. It's both bands together. It's heavy as fuck. It's so great. And I always tell people this. The singer of Max Webster was Kim Mitchell, who had the hit, "Might as well go for soda. Nobody hurts and nobody lies. Might as well go for soda."
No, that's right.
Walks in the booth, one take.
Yeah.
Well, studio time's expensive.
That's right. How do you feel about Saga?
Love. So I got asked to join Saga when I was 15 years old. I got asked to go to the keyboard player Steve Negus. I went to his house, which was an apartment. He had Saga. Gold Platinum Records. I was like 15. I looked like Angelina Jolie.
Yeah.
And I think that's why he wanted me in the band.
He's like, what happens with Steve Negus stays with Steve Negus. And he's like, he's like, listen, you're 15. I'm an adult man who plays keyboards. I'd like you to join this band. I'd like you to join this band. But do you like kissing adults?
Sebastian,
have you ever seen a grown man naked?
It happens with Steve Negus. Staves. Wow. Steve Negus.
Wow. All right.
That was pre Madam X?
Yes.
But
yeah,
wait,
that was Kid Wicked in Toronto. They wanted me to join
those
Saga.
Those are two bands. Those
weird?
Are two bands.
Yeah.
But to answer Joe, what are your top five Canadian bands?
Max Webster, April Wine, mm-hmm. Rush. Anvil, And, well, there's a band from Ottawa called Exciter, who I loved, and they had an album called Violence and Force, which was very much like Metallica. They had a song called Pounding Metal.
Oh, that sounds like that.
How
could
about
be.
Exciter?
How about
Killer
this?
Dwarfs.
Yes. How about this? Because I'm a crystal meth gummies. There was a time in this failing when the railroads.
Gordon Lightfoot. Yeah.
By the way,
in the grave and Jessica Mountain.
Yes. I collect all those albums. I collect
so,
all those.
So Gordon Lightfoot. Yes. Yeah. Let me tell you how much I love him. So
I love him too.
For me. I was at I've talked about this before, so sorry if it's boring, but it was another kind of eureka moment where people were talking about that track that is kind of like your internal speed, like the rhythm of your life, right? And I was at a dinner, and this was what people were talking about, like, what is that song? Like when you're driving down the road, what's that that tempo? And for me, consistently, like the first thing that popped into my mind is Sundown by Gordon Lightfoot.
You know
that, that's my song.
Do you know what mine is?
What?
Carefree Highway.
Carefree Highway.
Really?
Let me slip
this is
away
why I'm telling you.
Carefree Highway. Yes. Picking up the pieces of my sin and shattered dreams.
Oh my God.
I wonder how the old folks go to hay.
I'm not even singing the words.
Then I'll be damned if Charlie Collins. She left me not knowing what to do. Carefree Highway, let me slip away on you. Carefree Highway,
you've seen better days, the morning, afternoon, from my head down to my shoes.
Carefree Highway. Let me slip away on you.
Sebastian, that was a real panty dropper, if you know what I mean. Seeing you perform that song, I don't know if this is the right time to talk to you about
Saga.
What are you doing after the show?
Wind me up, you can't stop. You cry in the top of line with the moon. Cry in the top feet, kick and handle.
We've heard two new tracks from your new record.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh my God.
Let's do it.
I want crystal meth gummies.
Is there any Gordon Lightfoot on the new record?
No.
No.
But the first single, What Do I Got to Lose, is crushing it on radio.
Yes.
Okay, can we,
I didn't know that was still possible.
Do you mind if I play a little bit about
this? I would love it if you would. Okay.
I'm going to play that going into the break.
This is co-written with Miles Kennedy, who really did me a solid.
A huge voice, too, Miles. I mean, great fucking singer.
But, you know, like, I'm friends with a lot of rockers that are in bands. Like, Corey Taylor from Slipknot has always said, you know, you were one of my favorite performers as a kid. Even when he was first on the Jay Leno Tonight Show, he wore a Skid Row tour shirt from when he was a little kid because he said he was so nervous. And I really like Corey, but Corey's never written a song for me. Corey's never asked me to play a gig with him. Love you, Corey. But Miles was like, hey, dude, can I get you back on the radio? Like, can I write a song that's going to fucking crush the planet?
And I
want to thank Miles Kennedy for, I think, paying back. Mm-hmm. If he was a young kid listening to me singing Skid Row, for him to write songs with me in 2022, 2023, that's the way to pay back somebody. Ooh. He helped me out, man.
Bro.
And thank you.
I was embarrassed to drive to pick you up. I was like, is it going to be so lame? Because I had the top down in the car, and I was cranking this track. Are you going to play it now? We're going to take a quick break.
Everybody Bleeds?
No. What Do I Got to Lose?
Yeah. Fucking track. Turn it up.
Let's go to a break. We're going to be back.
But turn it up.
I've got to turn it up.
All right, it's Bocktails with Sebastian Bach. We'll be right back after this quick commercial break. I'm gonna try to make him have a glass of wine. We'll see what happens. What you do or say, I'm a bullhead ready to strike. Ain't got no time for
no compromise. Come and get it if you can tonight.
I don't do drugs, so I've got no friends.
Hey, Paul!
I don't get invited to any parties. Women ignore me. I don't even have a real job. Yeah, I've heard some people say drugs are cool, but they are wrong. Some of them are dead wrong.
We're empty, and you're holding a...
Okay, what kind is this? Ooh, Italian. Okay, right.
Okay, hold on. This is really special. Welcome back to Bach Tales with Sebastian Bach. You know, you were saying you don't drink on live television or a live broadcast, and you know, we have adult beverages. Can I please beg you?
Yes.
Will you just have a little bit of wine with us? You are a wine snob, right?
I am a wine snob. As a Rush fan, mm-hmm. I'm going to tell Brendan this. There was an article that Geddy Lee posted on his Instagram, which was an article that Rush did with Wine Spectator about Rush's favorite wines.
Was it
so like I read, and they went into detail, Alex Lifeson and Geddy Lee, and they're right into the wine.
They're but so, wine snobs.
Yeah, so Geddy Paul Lee, Stanley. I hung out with Geddy. I go, do you drink wine every night? He goes, yes, I fucking do. I like, because I try it, maybe not every night.
Yeah.
He goes, I'm not a good influence. He goes, every night at dinner.
Have you had, who?
And I was like, well, if I had my druthers, I would do that as well.
But those guys are drinking.
Who are the people that you've had that you can say they had a nice glass of wine with? Have you had some wine with Paul Stanley?
No.
He's another one.
Yeah, I have not.
He likes very specific, yeah. Really, he's got really great taste in wine. You don't know this?
Well, I do know that, and I know he makes his own wine. Yeah. I'd love to drink it with him sometime.
What about Maynard from Tool? Do you like his wine?
I haven't tried it yet. I'm great friends with Adam from Tool. Mm-hmm. Okay. I've asked to have some of Maynard's wine, But this article, Rush goes into detail about their favorite wines, and they love French Rhone Valley wines from the Rhone Valley. And their favorite that they say is Chateauneuf du Pape, P-A-P-E. Sure, you can get that at wine.
Sure, it's cheap crap.
That was
no, but you can get it at
also. But the Rush fans,
also
drink that.
I fucking have this article saved, also and I go Frank's. To the wine store and I go, I'll have whatever Rush is having. Thank you very much.
This just in.
And Frank,
yeah. Play the goddamn.
Hey, it wasn't potted up.
This just in. Also, Frank's favorite wine.
Chateauneuf du Pape?
Yes.
Are you kidding?
Yes.
That would be a good soundbite. Chateauneuf du Pape?
Because I never had any adult beverages
favorite.
With my father. And before my mother passed, I was like, wait, do we have like, there's like actually like a wine cellar that I didn't even know
but
that
But I thought
we
your
had.
Dad didn't drink wine. He did drink wine?
Yeah.
Okay.
Not when he was recording, right. Not when he was playing.
Not when he was on TV shows.
Oh, I saw him.
Monkeys.
I saw him send back. We went to Le Cirque one time.
Uh-huh.
And he ordered like a $5,000 bottle of wine.
Mm-hmm.
And I watched him drink it and send it back. I was like what? Six or
the
seven.
The whole bottle?
Yeah. And they were like, For real, you're gonna send this back? And say, yeah, it's no good.
Trash.
Give me another one. And I remember that being like really kind of fucking awkward because they made you like wear a suit and all that jazz. Yeah. So my dad did drink, and then I only found out what my dad really liked before my mother passed because I found out where she kept certain wine. Apparently, they would have wine. We'd go to sleep, or he'd work in the middle of the night or something, and maybe they'd have something. Totally unaware of that.
Wow.
And then hanging out with, there was no reason for me to ask his ex band members, the people that you know Frank loved to play with. He was like, no, Frank was always buying on the road. Not when we would play,
no.
But if we would hang out afterwards, he was always buying like, you know, tons of wine for everyone and nice wine. My dad was, you know, like a
expensive
macho
wine
Italian fucking, he liked good things.
Yeah.
But yes. So can we Please, can yes, we have a glass
yes,
with you?
Yes, but before we do that, I got to say, as a vinyl collector,
okay,
my favorite record from okay. your dad
okay.
is oh. Chic Your Booty.
Okay.
Oh.
Well, eventually, me and a friend, so we sort of drifted along into S&M. Well, I can take about an hour on the Tower of Power, as long as I get my little golden shower. Oh, God, I'm so fantastic. Thanks to Freddy, I'm a sexual spastic. And my name is Bobby Brown.
All right, so
watch me now. I'm going down.
Made a little speech then. Oh, she tried to make me say when.
Yeah.
She had my balls in a vice, but she left the dick. I guess it's still hooked on, but now it shoots too quick.
Okay, wait,
but I like that whole album, not just that song.
Wow. It's a great record.
I listened to that at Lakefield College School, where Prince Andrew went.
Well, that makes
maybe
that.
He fucking listened to that shit and took it too far.
Yeah, too far, damn it, too far. Do you know, we asked Bobby Brown randomly. I was in my dad's studio.
What, Cherry Pie Bobby Brown or Whitney Houston Bobby Brown?
Whitney Houston Bobby.
Okay.
Bobby Brown.
I was on a TV show.
That Bobby Brown, uh-huh. Right? So he came up to the house. And he was all excited to re-record Bobby Brown because I think he genuinely thought the song was about him.
I got a story.
Sincerely.
I got a story.
Okay. And then when he was in the studio, he's in the studio to record it. And then he read the lyrics. And he's like, I can't do this.
Dude, I was on a show with Bobby Brown called Celebrity Fat Club. No, Celebrity Fit Club.
Okay.
And I won the show, by the way. But there was a fucking, like a trivia contest as part of the show, right?
Okay, I can see you just killing everyone in that.
Well, Bobby Brown gets up, it's his turn. Mm-hmm. And the question was, finish the title of this hit song by Tommy Two Tone, 867. And we all look at each other and go, oh, for fuck, oh, 5309. We're all going this way. And Bobby Brown goes, 867-654-321. We go get the fuck out of here. He goes, 867-654-321. We go, what? We go, you don't know that fucking...
Sebastian.
867-5-4-3-2-1.
He was handed victory on
Sebastian,
a golden platter.
We were in shock.
I hope I can use this moment to, like you texted me, to reframe the situation. You know, it's live TV, and you know you can't expect legendary musicians like Bobby Brown, who you know
are high on crack.
Are
no. Hey,
wait. He might not have been.
867-5-3-2-1.
Yeah.
How do you not know that?
Yeah, no, that's tough. So are we gonna talk all about your record? Let's get out of here. Let's celebrate with some wine. Let's play your music.
Okay, so this is great wine. This is Italian. I will tell you it's a little too cold.
Yeah.
This is not 54 degrees. It should be 54 degrees. Oh, okay. I can tell by the touch. It's a little little cold.
Internally it might be.
The way you're stroking that bottle kind of
show us again.
Oh, I can take about an hour at a time of power. As long as I get my little golden shower.
Okay. Give the man a bottle opener.
Okay. He's got it. So I do love Italian wine. My favorite Italian wine is Barolo. Oh. Barolo.
Okay, well, this is not
delicious.
Not dissimilar.
No, this is from the same kind of area. Is this Piedmont? Is this Nebbiolo?
Mm-hmm.
You don't know. I just sang this
song. Oh, it's a Brunello, yeah.
Yeah, I just sang this song on The Masked Singer, by the way.
This song?
Yeah. I Was Made for Loving You. I did.
That's right.
Oh, my God. Was that a great experience?
It was.
What's it like being in The Mask? Or is it so claustrophobic?
It's like singing in bondage. It's
well,
like
that sounds
if I got
great.
Tied to the fucking bed and had to sing, it's the final countdown.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm saying, like, it's hard to sing because there's, like, a seatbelt in there, and you're like roped in and tied in.
Super and hot and sweaty.
Very hot and sweaty.
Does it smell so bad?
It can. Yeah.
Were they cool to you? Were the people cool to you behind
the scenes? They were cool to me, yes. I did have a great time, and they let me pick my songs that I sang, which was great.
Awesome.
That was... And I lost to Macy Gray, so...
That's okay.
Yeah. Well, good, so pretty good company. Yeah. Pretty
how
good.
Did how did Air Supply come about?
I'm a fan of Air Supply. When I was a kid in Peterborough, Ontario, I had a paper route. Mm-hmm. And I would get up 5:30 in the morning, deliver papers, and I bought a transistor radio, AM radio, double-sided tape, and I taped it to my handlebars so I could sing and rock out while I was delivering papers. And Air Supply, Lost in Love, was the biggest song. Lost in love and I don't know much, thinking about her in a touch, and I beckon my feet, eager to be what you wanted. Right on fucking key, you fucking hear that? Feeling a touch, and I beckon my feet, eager to drink some fucking red wine.
Can we just play any song and then just have them sing along?
Yeah.
Just play any song.
That should be the show. Yeah. AXS is... What, Axis? What the fuck in the channel?
My friend just took sing over along. The network. You know what?
What?
Dude, here's what we're going to do. Are you ready for this?
Yes.
I think we should do our own, like...
Show?
Yeah.
I got the title.
What's it called?
Don't steal it.
No, we're... Are we doing
that's
it?
That's the title.
Are we doing it?
I'm copywriting this shit.
Okay, uh-huh. What kind of a show is it? A sitcom? What is it?
It's about a club that you came to at my house. The name of the club is Vinyl Wino. And the purpose of the club
we play music
is to
and get
listen
drunk?
To vinyl and drink wino.
Okay.
And that's it.
Okay, my prediction.
Vinyl
my prediction.
Wino. I fucking made that up. Do not steal it.
No. Because
it's too good.
No, we're doing the show together. You have a co-host
Vinyl
now.
Wino.
I mean,
Vinyl Wino. Beat
that's
that
what's
title.
Happening.
Beat
okay?
that fucking title.
You'll see.
It's like not Savage that,
not,
Animal.
Not that fucking AXS is the be-all end-all. Great network, but... Great place to actually do this kind of a show. All right.
Hang on. I want to address everybody watching this show mm-hmm. that is 55 years old mm-hmm. or older. I will be 56 on April 3rd. When you're 55 years old, there comes a part in every day whether you have to make the decision, do I have another coffee or do I have my first glass of wine? What time is it?
Vinyl?
Time for this shit!
Vinyl!
Where's the fucking back? Cup?
Right child there. Within the man! Order!
My
order child within the man!
Shit. Yeah.
People
shit.
Watching
hold
the
on,
show,
hold on.
Go order child within the man yes. everywhere.
Before Brando has a heart attack.
Exactly. And on tour. Sebastian Bach on
oh
tour.
Oh my God.
Hang on.
If you're not in South America, don't worry about it because he's coming back to the States starting in May.
Yep.
Louisiana, Florida, all. Fucking over the place. Mm-hmm. Coming back to Southern California.
All right,
Santa Ana.
Yep.
Ventura, the Sunshine Theater in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Are you from New Mexico?
No.
Rockwell.
Tell everybody about it.
You are?
Yeah, Albuquerque. I grew up in Albuquerque. Yes. That's
Christ.
Where the metal comes from.
Wow.
Because our Native American
Sommelier Bach is on the... Is on,
Let me
Bocktails.
Let me show you my. Oh, you never told me about my wife Suzanne. You had to say something about that.
Oh, you know what? I was... when we went to the house,
okay.
I just felt... I sympathize for her because it felt like this was too much.
That's the story? Oh, I thought that was...
No, how old are your kids?
Well, I have a 10-year-old boy, Trace, and my 16-year-old daughter, Sebastian.
Yeah. So this was, I think he was maybe 4?
Yeah.
So it's late, and
right.
your 4-year-old is playing with, it's so loud.
Well.
And I'm like, I have, because I have a... 13-year-old and soon to be 8-year-old. Mm-hmm. So I was like, "Oh my God, this is so great!" I mean, your house—I didn't realize you had a little kid. And I was like, "Oh, maybe I had a whole fantasy that we were going to become best friends, and our kids were going to play." And I went over to your wife, I'm like, "Is there anything that you need?" And she was just not fucking having it. She was just so like taxed. So I can only imagine in that situation, you know, like 50 people in your house, and it was an unbelievable time.
It was.
But I'm sympathetic to the mom energy and all of those things
I
in that moment.
That.
To your wife.
Right on. And I'll I'll show you how she taught me to drink wine.
Okay.
Here's what she goes. Well, hang on. There's a whole way to do it.
Okay, well, teach me.
I would just drink the shit. You know?
So
she goes, what the fuck are you doing? You're not even tasting it.
So teach me. Okay,
so you just swirl it as much as you can.
Am I doing
it
right?
I don't know about you guys. I love wine so much.
Me too.
That I can put my honker in here and just leave it the fuck in there. Like this.
Like this? Am I doing it right?
I enjoy this.
Okay.
Can we do the rest of the show like this?
Yeah. Talk about, talk about.
Just this,
I'm all so out of love.
I'm so lost without you. I knew you were right.
So the second single off your record, Baz. Do you want to tell people about it?
Fucking, isn't that great?
The second single?
So then hang on. Since she goes, you go like this. You take a little bit and go like this.
You better be zooming on this night guy.
Bonus.
Hang on, I gotta fucking take a break reading this book.
Bonus, you know.
But anyways,
this is good.
This is great.
Yes.
See, it's kind of citrusy. It's citrusy, like when you put your nose in there. It kind of opens up my pores. Do you not feel that?
Oh.
My pores.
I have been I drank a whole fucking bottle with Richard at the table
today?
Already. So.
You did?
Yeah, it's empty, dude.
Holy shit.
Well, God, he helped.
This is great wine. This is great.
This is a good one. Who's on the line?
You're on Bock Tales with Sebastian Bock, the vinyl wino himself. Who are you? Where are you calling from? And what are you drinking?
White bananas. It's Sean from Illinois, boys.
Oh, hey, Sean from Illinois. Loyal.
Nice.
Loyal. And I just want to say that last night in the Ask Amit segment, Bastian, my question to Amit was, how fucking good is Everybody Bleeds?
Well, you just made my whole day, and the fact that you just called in at the end of the show and said that is really cool. Thank you very much. I worked on this album for 10 years.
Wow.
So I'm very excited to put it out. And I always, Amit has always known I'm a fan of Rock Tales, and he's been trying to get me on it since they were on Sirius. And I was like, dude, as soon as my fucking album comes out, I'm coming on the show. That was 1982.
And now here we are. And by the way, this for fans of yours, we have been waiting.
Yes.
And you know what? Some people, a record comes out and you're like, again, you know, like,
and then
your first two tracks are like, yeah, fuck yeah, he's fucking back and he's badder than ever. You're badder than ever. Your vocals, dude. I mean, we have such expectations. Right. Your vocals.
Wait till you hear the rest of the album. There's a song called Hold On or The Dream that is the heaviest fucking song I've ever done. Heavier than this one. This is the new one.
Dude, this is just, I mean, it punches you in the dick repeatedly, this song.
How about this riff? With the scream.
Oh my God! That happened in
the power of rock! The power of rock that this man has in every cell in his body.
Do not go out right now and pre-order his entire fucking record. Buy music. Don't fucking stream it.
Child
buy
the man.
Fucking record. He put 10 years of his fucking life into this.
I did.
The album art. It's so intentional. This is a man who's been waiting to give us this fucking record.
Cheers.
Buy it. Congratulations.
I love you.
To your fucking record release. We love you.
I love you, guys.
Thank you, Bach.
Thank you, Brandon.
Thank you, man.
Give me one big laugh.
Wow. This has been another edition, the first edition of Bock Tales.
That was like Barry White laughing.
Hey, now.
You'll never find.
weeks, but walking. Yeah.